It's no secret that I'm a fan of Persona. I've spent way too much time playing these games and then talking about them online. And with the recent release of Persona 3 Reload, it would appear that the yap hour is upon us once again. A few days before Reload released, I wanted to get a feel for Persona 3 by playing the PS4 version of Portable. And my thoughts on Portable are... chunky. No matter how well or poorly Portable has aged, it gave me enough baseline knowledge on Persona 3 to go into Reload with. And after finishing the game, I have to say, yeah, it's pretty good. So I wanted to take some time to talk about Reload, what I liked, what I didn't like, and maybe throw in a dumbass joke or two along the way. I'm gonna say this now to get it out of the way. There are going to be comparisons to Persona 5 Royal. It's the only other main game in the series that I've played. It was impossible for me to not compare both games during my playthrough. Both games have areas in which they're stronger and weaker than the other. While I may personally prefer one game over the other, they're both phenomenal experiences that I'd recommend to anyone. With that out of the way, let's talk about Persona 3 Reload and why it isn't as good as 5. When a game's remade, there's a number of things you expect to happen. The developers make changes to bring the game in line with modern standards, the classic story and experience becomes more accessible to a new generation of players, and the issues the original game had are fixed, most of the time.
Why you boring me? I'm right.
But I think the thing that everyone notices immediately is the visual change, and Persona 3 Reload is the perfect example of this. The transition from the original Persona 3 and Reload nearly gave me whiplash. I genuinely didn't think that the series could look any better than Persona 5 Royal, but somehow they managed to pull it off. The character redesigns are subtle yet effective, the way the models move in combat is smooth. I'd genuinely be happy if the series kept this level of visual fidelity without any major changes. Even the small changes from the original are incredible. The dialogue portraits are perfect, the in-game and animated cutscenes are brilliant, and even the lighting in Tartarus is perfect. And we don't need to mention the animation that plays when you hit an enemy's weakness. While playing Portable to prepare for Reload, I found it kind of difficult to fully immerse myself after playing Royal. The game felt more like a visual novel, with a dungeon crawler RPG as a side mode. I don't have anything against the design or aesthetic of the original, but what I'm saying here is that Reload makes the world, story, and characters of Persona 3 so much more accessible and digestible to newer fans, and that can only be seen as a good thing. The best way I can describe the visual upgrade is that the developers took the original PS2 game, grabbed a syringe full of Persona 5 flair, and did whatever the biggest guys at my gym do in the bathroom. And the stylishness doesn't stop at the in-game visuals, because fuck me, they decided to give a double dose to the user interface. Every menu is so dynamic and full of life, I probably spent over an hour just scrolling through my party stats and buying medicine. The amount of care and attention that was put into the UI alone is indicative of the effort that went into Reload as a whole. In an interview with the developers of Honkai Star Rail, the director of Atlus, Katsura Hashino, had this to say regarding the developers' approach to the user interface in their recent releases. In JRPGs, you spend a lot of time in menus, so the interface itself is part of the game, rather than being something separate. In Japan, UI design is often handled by new employees. Top-level designers are usually in charge of characters and background graphics, with the UI being secondary. I think that's a mistake. That's why Atlus UI designers are paid so well. Keeping with the theme of the updated visuals, all of the character designs have been modernized. The portraits, animations, and overall designs have been redone for every major character. On top of this, the persona and shadow models have all been updated, which was 100% necessary after looking at the originals. And while I appreciate that the shadow designs have also been updated, this is where my first complaint with the game comes in. The shadow designs get kind of dull. They just start out as dark blobs with masks on. And while that might be good enough for Glasgow, it's not good enough for me. Yes, the shadow designs become more varied the further you get into the game, but as you go along, you'll notice that a lot of the designs are just palette swapped and given different stats, moves, and weaknesses. I quite liked having to fight and recruit the personas in 5. It exposes the player to the personas they'll eventually be able to wield later in the game. Whereas in Reload, you get personas through getting cards after battle and fusing them. Half the time, I forgot what personas I even had equipped. Moving on from my only issue with the game's presentation, I have to talk about the music. It's no secret by now that I enjoy the music of the Persona series. I play it everywhere, at the gym, at work, in couples therapy because my wife hates it. With every Persona game I play, my playlist grows, and Reload is no different. The soundtrack features the likes of Lotus Juice and Azumi Takahashi performing some of the best vocal tracks I've ever heard from a video game. I've seen some people online saying that some of the songs are a massive downgrade from the originals, but I don't have any complaints other than the fact that they aren't all on Spotify yet. Listen, any game can look nice, but that's not enough. It has to be fun and distract me from my soul-crushing day job. With Reload, we see the return of a feature that I'm particularly fond of, the calendar. Once again, you have to manage your time between two aspects of your life, student shenanigans and phantom thievery. I mean, C's stuff. That'll do. You have to manage your time between your student life, where you do things like build relationships with people and go to school, and the RPG side of the game, where you make your way through Tartarus, the main dungeon of the game. You do this in between the story's deadlines, which come in the form of full moons. That's right, here in Persona 3, we operate on that astrology girl timetable, bitches. One issue that I have with the deadline setup being done this way is that they don't feel as urgent as they did in 5. In Persona 5, you need to infiltrate a palace and secure a route to the treasure before a certain date. Otherwise, there are real-world ramifications, like being expelled, arrested, or doxxed. But in 3, you aren't necessarily punished in the same way for being unprepared for a deadline. You'll probably just go into the full moon's boss fight underleveled, but that's it. There's a big boss fight almost every full moon, so that's your incentive to make your way through Tartarus, level up, and upgrade your gear. But being unprepared doesn't necessarily mean a game over, it just means that the boss fight will be tougher. This is almost definitely nitpicking on my part, but it's just something I wanted to say about the deadline system. And while I'm talking about my gripes with the gameplay, I have a really big one that I can't avoid any longer. Tartarus is fucking boring. Tartarus is a giant tower that appears during the Dark Hour. You spend your time in between full moons making your way up the tower, fighting shadows, rescuing people who've wandered in, and collecting treasure. It's pretty much the same as Mementos in Persona 5. And I know some of you are probably thinking that if I have a problem with Tartarus, then I should have a problem with Mementos too. I don't have an issue with Tartarus as a premise. My problem comes with the fact that Tartarus is the only dungeon in the game, which means that you spend the majority of your time climbing up 264 floors that largely look the same, with there only being 7 different floor designs. The difference between Tartarus and Mementos is that in Persona 5, your primary focus for dungeon crawling is the current palace within the metaverse. The palaces all have unique designs as they represent the cognition of their rulers. Mementos was much more of a supplementary side dungeon until the end of the game and the third semester. But in 3, you don't really have that much to break up the rut of running through Tartarus other than the full moon boss fights, which are few and far between. I know I've gone on a bit of a negative tangent, and it might seem that I'm using Persona 5 to illustrate what this game should have been, but allow me to fix that. Kinda. Big spoiler warning. I'll be talking more in depth about the events of the story, the characters and their development. If you want to avoid this, skip to the next section listed in the chapters in the description. The story of Persona 3 sees the main character, Makoto Yuki, or if you're me, Kitchen Sink, join C's, Specialized Extracurricular Execution Squad. You fight against shadows that appear during the Dark Hour, the secret 25th hour of the day that can't be perceived or experienced by people without the potential. The overall tone of the game feels a lot darker than 5. Like, 5 had its dark moments, we really don't need to go over Kamoshida and Shiho again, but 3 feels more consistently gloomy and serious, ranging from the nature of the Kurijo Group's research, the origins of Straga, and even the way you summon a persona to begin with.
Orpheus!
Throughout the story, you grow closer to your teammates, gain members, lose members, and fight together to end the Dark Hour. And after my playthrough, there are some aspects of the character dynamics and story setup that I actually prefer to 5. Within Persona 3, there are 4 members of the main cast who are tied to the Origin of Shadows and events that occur before the beginning of the game. Mitsuru's grandfather is the reason that Shadows exist in the first place, and her company is funding the fight against them. Yukari's dad was a researcher who sabotaged Mitsuru's grandfather and delayed the fall. And Aegis is a robot specifically created to destroy shadows, but when she was unable to destroy the Shadow of the Death Arcana, she sealed in within a young boy who was nearby. And who was that boy? Well, none other than Kitchen Sink. And it's not just the Dark Hour and shadows that characters are intrinsically linked to, but some of them are also linked to each other, like Mitsuru and Yukari being connected by the Kurijo Group's research into shadows, Mitsuru, Akihiko, and Shinjiro being the original C's team, Shinjiro and Ken are linked by prior events, and obviously Aegis and Makoto, considering she pretty much made him the chosen one. This structure makes it feel like these characters were always meant to find each other and fight against the shadows of the Dark Hour. In contrast, the Phantom Thieves don't have as much of a prior connection to the overall story of the metaverse other than Morgana and arguably Futaba. Every thief has a connection to a specific arc of the story in the form of the palaces, which is also a good way to arrange the story. I'm not saying that one structure is better than the other, I like them both. I'm just saying that the structure of 3 is a nice change of pace from my experience with 5. Although I've only focused on a few characters so far, every member of C's develops and matures throughout the story. For example, Junpei starts out as a pretty laid-back and immature guy who eventually meets a goth girl, builds a genuine connection, and finds a reason to fight other than being a hero. I mean, yeah, he starts being a dick in the middle of the game because he's not the main character, but he eventually resolves his issues, largely off-screen, and apologizes. Still better than Morgana running away, 6 out of 10 would tantrum again. Ken is pretty timid and reserved to begin with because he doesn't actually intend on staying part of the team, but he stops letting revenge dictate his choices and refuses to let his second chance at life go to waste. And Aegis goes from being a clingy Amazon Alexa with handguns to a true member of the group and everyone's favourite blonde toaster girl. I was really worried when starting this game that I wouldn't feel as strongly about these characters as I did about the Phantom Thieves, but that couldn't be further from the truth. But the characters that really fall flat for me are the social links. Some of the social links are pretty good. I think that the friend you make in an online MMO and the guy you meet at the shrine are both quite interesting. But my issue lies with the fact that you don't really feel that involved with any of these characters or their stories. You feel more like a passive witness than an actual friend. You kinda just watch them sort out their own problems. Oh, a fellow student wants to be groomed by a teacher? You go ahead, Chief, shoot your shot. A 9-year-old girl tells you that she's running away from home? I see no reason to intervene here or tell an adult. In Persona 5, you actually had a tangible impact on people's lives for the better. You actively helped them with their problems as the Phantom Thieves. I understand that Persona 3 is the game that introduced social links to the series, so they're naturally going to feel a lot more shallow than those in other games. The original intention of this might have just been about just being there for someone being enough to change their life, which is a really nice message. But personally, I just felt like I was watching people work stuff out on their own. Like, I could not give less of a shit about the guy on the student council. In summation, I love C's, the social links for the most part were kind of flat. Koromaru supremacy, fuck you Morgana. Overall, I absolutely love Persona 3 Reload, even if I'm having to play it again to max out all the social links for the Platinum. That doesn't infuriate me, not at all. While Persona 5 Royal is still my favourite game in the series and in general, Reload has definitely given it a run for its money, with lovable characters, a great story, music that makes me wish I could rap, and an ending that was spoiled for me by a comment on my Persona 5 dancing video, don't try and hide, you know who you are! With this absolute triumph for Atlus and JRPGs in general, I can't help but feel excited about everything on the horizon. The episode Aegis DLC, Atlus's new JRPG Metaphor, and the remakes of Persona 2 and 4 that are rumoured to exist within Atlus. Persona 3 Reload deserves nothing lower than a 9 out of 10, and it's a very strong contender for my personal game of the year. I'm actually really looking forward to looking at all the Persona 3 spin-offs.